All right, so this morning we are in the fourth chapter of Paul's letter to the Romans, or to the Roman church. And what Paul is going to do in this chapter is now particularly use Abraham as an example of what he has been declaring to be true with regard to the gospel. So last week we looked particularly at a very technical explanation of what it meant to be justified by faith in Jesus Christ. Paul is now going to apply that, particularly to Abraham, because, and we'll see in just a minute, how significant Abraham was to the Jewish people in particular. And so as we look at verse 1, that's exactly what he says. What then shall we say was gained by Abraham, our forefather, according to the flesh? So this is going to confirm what he's already said, but it's also going to address in his mind, a Jewish objection to what he's already said. And as we've said in the past, Paul does that as a way of writing, that he anticipates objections that people are going to have to what he has to say, and then he kind of creates a pretend dialogue with that person, with the understanding that that person then takes the side of the objection, and Paul will then argue with him over whether that is a correct understanding or not. So the phrase, according to the flesh, actually is a little unclear. It could refer here to, it could modify the word gained. So what has Abraham gained according to the flesh? If that's the connection, then what Paul is talking about is, what has Abraham gained by all the good things he did, all the works that he accomplished? On the other hand, according to the flesh, can modify our forefather according to the flesh, which would then mean Abraham, who is our ancestor, our Jewish ancestor, our forefather in the Jewish race. Either one fits, and neither one is going to change the outcome of Paul's argument. So I can't make a distinction, and I don't think most of the commentators really could either. But the key here is that to the Jew, every Jew would have agreed that Abraham was justified. The question was, how was he justified? And so that's what Paul is going to deal with. And you'll see that really in verse 2. For if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. So Paul recognizes that the Jews revered Abraham as their father, and his life and character have always been held up as models with not only the way that God works with his people, but of true piety, true religious fervor as a Jew. And so much so that virtually all Jews at the time of Paul, at least, believed that Abraham was righteous and he sustained that relationship with God in covenant on the basis of his obedience, on the basis of his faithfulness. That is basically that he had earned his way into God's good pleasure. And so Paul is really addressing probably the strongest point that the Jew would have against what he had to say, because they truly did believe that Abraham was justified, but he was justified by works. And if he was justified by works, then certainly they should be able to be justified by works. And that's contrary to what Paul has been arguing. So strong was this belief that some Jews actually believed and taught that Abraham had obeyed the law perfectly even before it was given. Because you remember, the law wasn't given until Moses, 430 years after Abraham. And yet, even though the law wasn't given to Abraham specifically, there were Jews that actually believed he'd obeyed it perfectly. And I gave you a quote. Now, this is later. This is from the Book of Jubilees. So it's 2nd century BC, a couple hundred years before Paul. And this is a quote right out of the book. Abraham was perfect in all his deeds with the Lord and well-pleasing in righteousness all the days of his life. So their view was pretty high on Abraham, and the view was that Abraham actually had worked his way to salvation. And so...
So does that discount the lies to Pharaoh and all those things? Or God said those aren't sin?
It is interesting, yeah.
I'm sorry to get off on the track, but I'm wondering, are they saying that those things didn't happen, or are they saying that God didn't count that as sin?
It's hard for me to know, because quite honestly, I think we all recognize that that though Moses was a very godly man, he was a sinner. And even in the, Abraham, and even in the descriptions of what happens in the wilderness, we see that, you know, he's not allowed to go into the, I'm talking about Moses, so never mind. Abraham, I mean, we see those things, like you said, we see the failures of Abraham down in Egypt. We see his failure with listening to Sarah and going ahead and having a child by her concubine and so forth. And so, I don't know whether they just had such a high view, they just ignored that, or they were looking at it in the way that Paul, Paul talks about himself as being righteous, but I think what Paul is saying in his letters is that he was outwardly righteous. He kept the law, he followed the law. He wasn't talking about an inward disposition, his attitude or anything like that. But even then, that's quite a bold statement. So it's hard to know, and I'm a little surprised that the Jews would have held that view, but it was so strongly held that I think Paul felt the need that he had to address it here. Otherwise, he was going to lose his Jewish audience. And but also, I want you to see that this is really a test case. If he can show that Abraham was justified by faith, the Jews really don't have any grounds to stand on. I mean, if they recognize that the man they revere the most in their Jewish history was truly justified by faith, then they don't really have a ground to stand on against Paul. And that's why he's focused there, I believe. The other thing that I think is true here for Paul is that Abraham's, even in the Jewish eyes, was the first one and therefore the example of how God is working with his people, how God has set up this relationship with his people and how it's supposed to go. And so if this is the way that he has done it with Abraham, then this is really the way that God is going to be working with people throughout history. And we're going to see that in just a moment when we go to Galatians. I'm going to hold off on that verse for just a minute. So what Paul starts with is he starts with just a statement, but not before God. That is, when we consider God's viewpoint here, Abraham was not right. He had no right to boast at all. Now, Paul doesn't prove that here. In fact, Paul doesn't actually prove it at all in the letter. We're going to see how he addresses it. But here he just makes the statement. Abraham has nothing to boast about before God at all. Nothing. And then he goes on, verse 3, but what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness. So the reason Abraham has nothing to boast about is we have a statement in Genesis 15, verse 6, which proves that it was by faith, not by law keeping. The interesting thing about Genesis 15, 6 is two things. One is it's the very first use of the word believe in scripture. And so I think in part, Paul is using it because it has that word in it, which he has been using here, that salvation is for those who believe. He's introduced that phrase early on in the book of Romans. And now he's showing that if we go all the way back to Abraham, we have the use of that very same word. And we have it used in the context of righteousness, which is almost non-existent in the Old Testament. Those two words are rarely used together. And so Paul has found a text where they are used together, and he's found a critical text because of when it occurs in the life of Abraham. The other thing that's important here, even though Paul doesn't say it, is if we look at Genesis 15:6, we see not only Abraham's complete trust in God and God's promise, but But God's promise in 15:6 is his promise of a child, a natural born child, who would be his legitimate offspring. In fact, in Genesis 15:6, it begins by Abraham being frustrated, waiting. Yes, God had promised him offspring as numerous as the stars in the heavens and the sands of the sea, and yet he has none. And he says, "Oh Lord, may it be my servant, Eliezer, that becomes my heir." Because that was, at the time, if you were childless, it was not unheard of that you might take a servant that particularly was very faithful to you and had been of great service to you, and make that servant your heir in place of having a child. And so that's what Abraham wants to do. And God says, no, it's not going to be your servant, but it's going to be a child of your own birth. But if you look at Genesis 15, it's really a renewal of the promise that God made in Genesis 12, where he told Abraham that he'd have offspring as numerous as the stars and the sands. And so it includes all of that. And we're going to see in just a minute that Paul argues in Galatians that that declaration to Abraham was in fact the preaching of the gospel. And so it ties in with this righteousness that comes from Christ. As we look at this initially, we say, well, we see Abraham believing God's promise in a child, but we don't see how it relates to Christ. But it does, and it does in Paul's mind, because he recognizes that as we go down through history, that promise sees its fulfillment in a Savior. Again, the other thing that is noted here is the word counted. That is, again, as we said before, last week particularly, it means to lay something to one's account and to count them as accordingly. And I used the example last week with Andy, and I'll make it more, Andy. Bezos gives you $1 billion. I just read on one of the news things that he's now the world's first billionaire.
Trillionaire.
Wow. So $1 billion is nothing to him. Yeah. I mean, he'd give it away and he wouldn't even know it was gone. So he gives you $1 billion. Not only does that get credited to your account, but now you get treated as a billionaire because you really are. Mm-hmm. And that's what this idea of counted or imputed means. It's an accounting term where someone gives you something, particularly lays something to your account, and then counts you according to whatever is there. In your case, a billionaire. In the case of Abraham, it was righteousness. God credited his faith to righteousness. But I want you to understand, it's not the faith that made Abraham righteous. Paul is not saying that. Faith is the means by which he was credited as being righteous. But the righteousness, even for Abraham, is Christ's righteousness, even though it's not said so in the passage. And you remember that even Jesus said about Abraham, Abraham longed to see my day, and he saw it. Well, he saw it by faith, because he never saw it in person. Okay, so what Paul is saying then is that Abraham was declared to be righteous. And I think the other thing we need to see here is that we recognize from Scripture, and from particularly what Paul says, is that all men are in need of what we called last week an alien righteousness, a righteousness that isn't theirs. No person that's ever been alive has done anything that would obligate God, and therefore they need a righteousness that comes from someone else. And Paul's argument is that it comes from the Lord Jesus Christ. Because that is the situation of all people. All people need a Savior. Therefore, we noted last week what Paul said was that God's salvation is therefore suited to all people, and therefore it's the righteousness of Christ for everyone. And so if he's going to use an example of Abraham, he's already implying to us by simply using him that he was saved in the same way that we are. And then he'll make that case later on, is because if we do believe as Abraham believed, which is the same belief in Christ, then we are Abraham's children. We are his spiritual children as a result of that. So if I look at Galatians chapter 3, starting in verse 6, Paul says, just as Abraham believed God and it was accounted to him as righteousness. So there again, we have that phrase. Know then that it was those of faith who are the sons of Abraham. And the scriptures foreseeing that God would justify all the Gentiles by faith. So here's that word justified back in there again, and it's Gentiles and it's faith. He preached the gospel beforehand to Abraham. You say, well, I don't remember the gospel being preached in the Old Testament. And then he says, saying, and here's the quote from Genesis 12, in you shall all the nations be blessed. So then those who are of faith are blessed along with Abraham, the man of faith. So part of what God was saying to Abraham when he gave that promise to him was that that blessing that was going to come through faith in a Savior that he would be a part of. Then Paul goes on to give us a principle that's pretty obvious. He says, now to the one who works, his wages are not counted as a gift, but as a due. I think we all know that. If we work, we get our wages as an obligation. I mean, can you imagine if, Larry, I know work for a while. Did you work at Wendy's?
McDonald's.
Can you imagine working for McDonald's and coming to, and the boss comes around payday and he says, Larry, here's your gift. I give it to you out of the goodness of my heart. You'd be
great. What? Thank you. Now give me my
wages. Yeah, now give me my wages. Because wages are earned. It's something that our employer is obligated to give us because they've done the work. The gift is something we haven't done anything for. And so he says, you know, if you're working for something, then the wages are counted as a gift, as something that's due you. Again, trying to look at this theology that the Jews had, first of this, yes, faith was involved. Yes, there was a trust, but there was also works that were involved as well. And Paul is trying to get away from this idea of works. And so he's arguing that that if it were works, then really what God has done, you remember last week, he's already said this justification that comes from God is a gift. He's already declared that it's a gift of grace. And so he says that, you know, if it really were if works were a part of it, it wouldn't be a gift. It couldn't be a gift because you can't really earn a gift. That's kind of the definition of a gift. So he says, and to the one who does not work, and here he means not that he doesn't do anything. I think some people have actually taken the verse to mean that. But what he means is who do not have any works to offer for their righteousness, or who have nothing to show for that, or even realize that it wouldn't do any good to work for one's righteousness, but trusts him who justifies the ungodly. His faith is counted as righteousness. Again, what he's arguing is Genesis 15:6 makes no mention of works by Abraham. It only talks about Abraham's faith, Abraham trusting God, and God counting that as his righteousness.
There's a point you have up here that I'm really starting to, you know, faith is not the grounds of justification. It's not the quality of your faith, or else it would become something that you could compare to another's.
Yeah, it's not the quality. In fact, it's not the basis by which we are justified. It's the means by which we're justified.
That's why faith of a mustard seed, because it's not your faith that moves the mountain. It's God saying, yes, that's faith.
Yes.
And so regardless of what, either God accepts that, yes, you have faith, or he says, no, you don't. It's a yes, no, not a quantity thing.
Right. In fact, you remember when we looked at Pilgrim's Progress, we saw some that had great faith, and we saw some that were just kind of getting by with just enough faith to move forward, but they were both.
But that, I think that's one of the stumbling blocks that the new Christian has when they get saved. they're justified, they're forgiven, we're going, got eternal life, and then they sin again. And it's like, oh, maybe I'm not saved. Maybe I'm not good enough. Maybe God didn't save me. And it's this idea of it's not how well you did.
Yeah.
It's do you have faith?
Yeah.
And that faith says, I have faith that God forgave me, even when I don't feel worthy.
Absolutely. And now he's going to develop that later on as he gets into, away from justification, into really what is sanctification. He's going to talk about what is expected, but also what is real, mm-hmm. what is realistic in that whole process. Because he's very honest in chapter 7, which I truly do believe, as you look at what's there, this is Paul after his conversion. He's struggling still with sin in his life. And if Apostle Paul can struggle with sin in his life, and so can we, we're not going to be exempt from that. And we are going to have to, as Larry mentioned, we're going to have to deal with that in terms of what does that mean in terms of our walk with God and where we're at with him. It does not necessarily mean that we have no faith. In fact, with Paul, the very fact that he wants to do the right thing shows that he's got faith, because no unbeliever would ever want to do the right thing. He's already said that in chapter 3. No one desires God. No one wants to please him. No one. So those are the unbelievers. They have no desire to do that. So if you have a desire, small as it is, that's the beginning step. So I believe. So good. Good point. I want to look at just briefly at that phrase too, him who justifies the ungodly. This is, of course, a reference to God, but it's a very bold statement. Because in Exodus 23:7, God made it clear, I will not justify the wicked. Now, the texts are a little different. God is saying there, if you're going to live wickedly, I will not justify you. And yet God has justified the wicked, because he has, as we saw last week, he has punished his own son instead of them. So the beauty of the gospel, I think, was in the phrase last week, God can be just and the justifier of those who are sinful. And that's exciting for us, because we will never be righteous on our own. And that's Paul's argument. But again, we have to see our bankruptcy. Let's put it that way. We talked about Andy being a billionaire, but in order to get the money, we have to see that we're bankrupt. Mm-hmm. We can't see that we have something in our bank account that we think we can use. We're not going to buy our way into God's righteousness, into a relationship with God with our $25 or $1,000 or whatever it is, because God's not open to that. God's going to credit us with everything that we need, but we have to receive it as a gift and recognize that we can in no way deserve it or earn it. So he's going to stop for just a moment here now. He's going to come back to Abraham. He has much more still to say about Abraham. But I think he's made a good argument. Yeah. About Abraham. He's going to come back to circumcision in just a moment. But he stops for a moment and he adds another illustration, another, I guess we can say, example of what he's talking about by using David. And again, next to Abraham, probably Abraham, Moses, and David are the three greatest figures in the Old Testament. King David was highly revered. So he goes to David and he quotes from David's Psalm 32. Now, David's confession of sin was Psalm 51, but in Psalm 32, David talks about that time when he hid his sin from God and he felt the pressure of God's righteous hand pressing down upon him. He was miserable for the whole year until finally the prophet Nathan came to him and he realized his sinfulness and he confessed it. And then he was so amazed at how quickly God forgave him when he finally confessed his sin. But what David says in those first two verses of Psalm 32 really do focus on the very thing that Paul is arguing here, because David doesn't speak of God rewarding the righteous. Rather, he speaks of God's free acceptance of those who are unworthy, because he's talking about himself in his sinfulness. So he talks about things like transgressions forgiven, sin covered, sin not counted, Those are not phrases that we would use about crediting somebody's good works. It's rather, I guess we say, ignoring or setting aside because of something else that's happened, someone's sinfulness. So let's look at these words.
It's forgiving a debt.
It is. It's forgiving a debt. So the phrase is pretty well right out of Psalm 32, 1 and 2. Blessed are those whose lawless deeds are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man against whom the Lord will not count his sin. Here's that word again. He finds it everywhere, you know, so to reckon or to count. But here it's just the opposite, isn't it? Before we talked about something good being accounted to us and us being recognized as to what we are with this new accounting. So Andy got the $1 billion from Bezos. Here, it's something that we have that's not good, our sin, and that's being not counted against us, which is just the opposite. But again, that's the way it works in justification. You know, Paul says Christ became sin for us that we might be the righteousness of God in him. So we receive his righteousness, but he takes our sin from us. Our sin is imputed to him. Our sin is counted to him, and that's why he died on the cross. And so that's the way David speaks. David says, that sins are forgiven. Transgressions are forgiven, sins are covered, and God does not count one's sins against him. So again, it's the not counting or the not reckoning of sin that leads to forgiveness. It's not the reckoning of good works. It's not the making someone a righteous person, but rather not counting those sins that they committed. Now, again, we could say, is that what the Jews are doing? But I don't think that's what the Jews were doing. This is Paul's theology now, because he recognizes what God has done for the sinner. I don't know, and it's a good question, Larry. I don't know if we could even find the answer, what the Jews actually thought it was, because Paul is arguing this is completely different than the way they were looking at justification.
It seems to me that in Genesis, when it was all started, the sacrifice of the lamb and the understanding that I'm not doing anything, I'm killing this lamb and God's saying I'm accepting it, I think they kind of understood that. It's when they got the law, all of a sudden, it's like, it's not just killing the lamb. It's also doing this. They misunderstood the purpose of the law. And that, you know, you said in one of your other points is they took faith and the law and tried to put them together. Yeah. That they work together. You know, you get more out of when you put them together, you get more than if you just had the one or the other.
Okay, so hang on to that and we'll see if it fits, because I think it does. The two things here, though, again, that I want you to see in Paul is forgiveness is related to justification, and very clearly from what David says. To be justified means to be forgiven. It means so much more than that, but that's a part of what we look at. You remember last week we looked at that whole concept of being our sins being atoned for, our sins being propitiated as a result of what Christ had done. And the second thing is, again, this strong, I'm going to use the words forensic, just so you see it's a legal term. Paul has been arguing this all along. Justification is a declaration that we are not guilty, that we are not to be condemned, but rather that we are considered to be righteous. It's not a making us righteous, but it's a declaration. And last week we noticed it's a declaration that if we really put our faith and trust in Christ, that declaration can never change and can never go away. We'll never be declared the opposite of that. It's a one-time only thing that happens if we truly have put our faith and trust in Jesus Christ. And we said that because there's so many teachings out there that says that you can lose your justification. You can lose your salvation. You can't, because God declares it to be so and God does not change his mind. So if you truly trusted in Christ, then that declaration will be true forever. And part of that declaration is this non-imputation. God is declaring that your sins are not going to be held against you, and that you are not going to be condemned as a result of that. So it's both sides, and Paul is arguing both sides, and he's very strong about that because he wants us to be so clear that justification, the way that the Reformer said it, is it's a one-time act of God. It's not a process like sanctification or like glorification. It's a one-time act. It's a picture in a courtroom where the judge hammers down the gavel and says, not guilty, not condemned, righteous, because of imputed righteousness. And it never changes. It can't change because God has declared it to be so. And I think that's so important. We're going to see why later on in this book, why God wants us to be absolutely sure that we are saved. He doesn't want us to wonder day by day, well, am I or am I not, you know, and wonder all the way to our death whether or not, as Larry said, do we have enough faith to be saved? God wants us to be assured that if we really trusted in Christ, we are saved, and that will never change. And I think that's so important that we see that's important to God, and it's important for us to have that assurance, and we'll see how we get it later. The next part, though, Paul is going back now to another objection, I think, and that has to do with circumcision. He's already shown that circumcision, or he's already stated that works have no part in our justification, and that includes being circumcised. So that's a big issue with the Jew, because that was central in their thinking, was that you needed to be circumcised. In fact, if you were a Gentile and you wanted to be part of the Jewish nation, that was the first thing you had to do. You had to be circumcised. You could not be a part of the people of God in the Old Testament without being circumcised. And so Paul's now going to attack that. Verse 9, is this blessing, that is, the blessing that has been conferred on Abraham and the blessing that David talks about when he realizes the forgiveness that God has given to him, even in his sinfulness, is this blessing then only for the circumcised or also for the uncircumcised? In other words, is it just for Jews or can Gentiles have it as well? And then he says, we say that faith was counted to Abraham as righteousness. Now that's just a requoting of Genesis 15:6. But I think he's addressing here a further criticism of his argument, which basically says, even if you can show that righteousness comes from as a gift of God's grace through faith, as in the case of Abraham, have you forgotten that Abraham is the father of the circumcised, not the uncircumcised? So how does that relate to Gentiles? Now, in this verse, Paul doesn't say. He actually just reminds us, I think, that the key verse is Genesis 15:6. Keep that in mind. In fact, it's really interesting that I always thought he had actually given an explanation, but that when you read this over, you realize that he has assumed that this Jewish audience particularly knows Genesis. That they know that Genesis is a book written in chronological order, and that if you look at the chronological order of Abraham's life, you can see that what he is saying is absolutely true. But he never actually demonstrates it in the letter itself. He merely makes the comment, how then was it counted to him? Really, we might paraphrase that. When was it counted to him? Mm-hmm. When in his life was he declared to be righteous? Was it before or after he was circumcised? It was not after, but before he was circumcised. So he's already stated and shown that Genesis 15:6 shows that Abraham was declared to be righteous before he was circumcised. He was not circumcised in Genesis 15. So when was he circumcised? If we look at the chronology, we see it's not till chapter 17 that Abraham is actually circumcised. So in 15, God makes this covenant with Abraham, and Ishmael isn't even born yet. In fact, Ishmael isn't even isn't even on the horizon yet. If we look at Genesis chapter 17, verses 10 and 11 and 24 through 26, we see that Abraham is 99, Ishmael is 13, and the text says they were both circumcised on the same day. So Genesis 17 has to be at least 14 years later than Genesis 15. The 13 years of Ishmael's life and the year, approximate year in the womb. Mm-hmm. But it could have been a lot more than that. It can't be less than 14 years, but it could be more, because we don't know when from Genesis 15, how many years it was before before Sarah became pregnant with Ishmael. The Jews, the rabbis, say 29 years. I have no idea where they got that number. It's not even a good number. but they say 29 years. But the point is, it's a minimum of 14 years later. So here's circumcision, and it's important. And Paul is not denying the importance of circumcision. But what he's saying is circumcision didn't have any part to play in Abraham's being justified, because it didn't come until at least 14 years after that event's already been declared. So what is the importance of circumcision? And I think it has more than one significance, but Paul is going to focus on one particular one here. And he says, he, that is Abraham, received the sign of circumcision as a seal of the righteousness that he had by faith while he was still uncircumcised. So the righteousness that he received when he was uncircumcised because of his faith is now signified and sealed to him in this act of circumcision. In fact, he says this sign of circumcision. So it's a sign, and therefore it signifies something. It signifies something other than itself. And I think we can even see that in the signs that we have around us. The signs never point to themselves. They always point to something that they're signifying. Even, I think, correct me if you think I'm wrong, but I've often even looked at the traffic signs, like the stop signs that we have. You don't look at the stop sign and marvel at its beauty or of its integrity or the fact that it's eight-sided or red or whatever, but you know immediately that it's pointing to something else. It's signifying that you need to put the brake on the car and not cross the intersection until you've checked to make sure it's safe. The sign points to something else. And here, often, I think the sign and the thing that signified are very closely related. So what is it that circumcision signifies? Well, I think it comes from the very fact of what we've talked about before. You remember, we looked at those verses a couple weeks ago that said that God circumcised them outwardly, but told them what he really wanted was a circumcision of their heart. Mm-hmm. That's what he was after. And so circumcision, in the truest sense of the word, means an exorcism or a removal, not so much of the foreskin externally, but of the guilt and the pollution of one's heart. Now, it also was an outward sign of the Old Testament people of God. That is, you could be circumcised and part of the Jewish nation and not have the faith of Abraham. In other words, you could just be physically marked off as a Jew. And there are probably millions of Jews that are that way today. They have been circumcised, and so they're truly Jewish people, but they're not children of Abraham in the spiritual sense. They don't have the faith of Abraham, but they've got the outward markings. So there is that distinction. But what God was really looking for with circumcision was something inwardly that matched the outward. So I'm not saying it's equivalent to baptism, because it clearly is not, but it's related to baptism in that what God really intended for those people was that they would be like Abraham. He was circumcised outwardly, but he believed inwardly. He trusted God. He believed in his promise. And because he had the faith, he was justified, not because he was circumcised. Paul also says it's a seal. That is, it confirms the truth or the reality of something else. To Abraham, it was his guarantee of God's trustworthiness to God's promise. God had made a promise. God had fulfilled that promise, was fulfilling that promise, and circumcision was a sign and a seal of that promise. But it was of what had already happened to Abraham. So it wasn't something, circumcision didn't change the status of Abraham, it just confirmed it. Just placed a seal on it. And in a sense, that's what baptism does, right? Baptism doesn't save us. There are people who believe that it does, but scripture is really clear. Baptism doesn't save us. What it does is it really does. It's a sign and a seal to us of something that's already happened. And if it hasn't happened, then baptism doesn't mean anything. It's worthless. It only has value if it really depicts what's in your heart.
It's a material confirmation of a immaterial fact.
Good. Yes. It's an outward sign of an inward reality.
Right. Being born a Jew, you can say, well, my mom and dad are Jews, but really the fact that you are of the Jewish nation, if you went traveling abroad, you can definitely, on the eighth day after I was born, this happened to me, and it's an indication that I am a Jew. Mm-hmm. It's very hard to, and in fact, it says nobody but God knows your heart. You can't go and prove that you're justified. But when your faith's being tested, you could, on this day, I went before the church and proclaimed my faith. There's a concrete thing that's a symbol, a seal, a representation of what God did.
And it's intended for that. Right. I think at this point, the Protestant reformers were right when they said that it's a means of grace, in that when you see it, whether it's for you or you're watching, let's say we're watching someone else's baptism, and we think back to ours, and we say, that moment when I was baptized was the outward symbol of what I felt in my heart. I belong to Jesus, and I remember that event. And that encourages us. It reminds us, yes, I've been there. I've made that declaration. I publicly declared Jesus my Savior and was baptized. And that's exciting. There are times when we struggle, and when we look back upon that, it should be a strengthening of our faith through the power of the Spirit to do that. But if it's not true, then it shouldn't do that. And that's why when we get into looking at what should be happening to us now that we have believed, that's where the assurances are going to come from.
Because in both cases, you can be circumcised and not be a Jew. You can get baptized and
not be a Christian. Absolutely. Absolutely. And you got to watch out for that. Because as we talked before, it's not the rituals that we go through that make us believers. It's how we feel in our heart and whether we've trusted in the means by which God justifies people, and that's Christ and his
when
work.
When we baptized a child, mm-hmm. like the Catholics do, Catholics always baptize children.
Yes.
Okay. The child has no idea what's going on.
Right.
The infant has no idea what's going on, but the audience does. So when the audience sees the child being baptized, it indicates to the audience that this person now is a member of the church. Okay. Now, typically, you should be baptized again when you're old enough to understand what's going on. But to me, the baptism is very important to the audience.
Well, it is important to the audience.
Less important to the child.
Well, yes, and of course the Catholic view is different than ours, because Catholics do believe in baptismal regeneration, so they believe the child is actually being saved. Nonetheless, if we can leave that out for the moment, baptisms do have an impact on the congregation as well, and should have. That's why it's fun, it's not only fun, but valuable for us to see a child, a young child come to faith. I don't know how old you guys were, but
I think
22. No.
Neither of us are 22.
Yeah. I know, I'm not kidding.
Were you both six?
They were both around.
Yeah, you guys were really young. I remember that. And so that's neat when we see a young person come to faith in Christ and be able to publicly proclaim it. It should be an encouragement to every one of us who sees that, whether we're your parents or not. That's exciting for us. That's why when there's a baptism, everybody goes, because mm-hmm. we want to see that happen. That's a big event in the life of the church. So
the other thing to remember is that, you know, baptism of salvation, baptism after salvation, isn't the only baptism mentioned in the Bible.
No.
John the Baptist baptized with water. And then in the Old Testament, there were baptisms, to represent, cleanliness, the desire for the forgiveness of sin versus the actuality of God's righteousness. So, it's not that, the Catholic practice is necessarily wrong. It's the belief that that will save the child, that they don't have to have faith. That's what that's the danger, is the misunderstanding of what it means.
Okay, so let's look at the purpose why God gave circumcision to Abraham specifically, because it's a little different why he gave it to others, because Paul says the purpose was to make him, that is Abraham, the father of all who believe without being circumcised, so that righteousness would be counted to him as well. So what Paul is saying here is that Abraham was assured of his justification in order that he might be the father of believing Gentiles. That's God's design, was that Abraham, as we're going to see how Paul puts it, Abraham is the father of those who are circumcised and also believe as Abraham believed, but he's also the father of those who are not circumcised but share that same belief. And God set it up so he could be both. And here we see it is in the sense that circumcision is not the determining factor. If circumcision was, it would be hard to see how Gentiles would fit into having the same relationship to God as Abraham. But circumcision is not central to Abraham's faith. It didn't add anything to it. It symbolized it, it sealed it, but it didn't change it, and it didn't add anything to it in any kind of way. Mm-hmm. And so in that sense, Abraham then is the father of all of us, because we're the spiritual children, we're the Gentiles who have believed. And it also allows us to see that, in fact, that's what God is doing. That is, he is giving us a righteousness that is not ours. Our faith is reckoned to us. Our faith is imputed to us. Through our faith, our righteousness is imputed to us. But also, notice verse 12, and to make him the father of the circumcised who are not merely circumcised, but who also walk in the footsteps of the faith of our father Abraham. Our father Abraham had before he was circumcised. So Abraham, even being circumcised, then the Jews can look to him, as long as they look to him, as Larry said, correctly. They need to see him not just as a man who is circumcised, but a man who is circumcised and also has faith in what God is doing through his life. And so as long as they demonstrate that faith, as long as they walk in the footsteps of Abraham's faith, then they also can be justified as Abraham was. But if they're going to just rely on his circumcision, which is, I think, where we started this whole discussion back in chapter 2, where the Jew was saying, I'm born a Jew and I've been circumcised a Jew and I'm good to go. I don't need anything else. And Paul has been arguing all the way through that. No, you're a sinner. You don't keep the law. Circumcision isn't going to save you by itself. It's valuable, but it's not something that is going to help you in the day of judgment. So therefore, Abraham is the father of both. And it's really through faith. And I think this is important for us. I mean, when we look back, you know, we claim to be saved. We claim to be children of God, and we're not part of the nation of Israel. You know, we are part of what Paul is going to say later, spiritual Israel, but we're not part of the nation of Israel.
The seed of Abraham.
Yeah, seed of Abraham, the children of Abraham. You know, I think sometimes when kids don't understand that concept, we sing, Father Abraham had many sons, and kids kind of scratch their heads and go, what? Why are we singing that? But if you understand what Paul is saying here, we get excited about that, because we are sons and daughters of Father Abraham, because we have the spiritual faith that Father Abraham had. And therefore, even though we've never been circumcised, we still are his spiritual children. So it is significant, and it is exactly what God had in mind when he told Abraham he would be a blessing to many, many nations. That's where the blessing comes through the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, so let me stop here with the recording, and then we'll see if there's any further discussion. I know it's been a challenging couple weeks, because we've looked at a very technical explanation of what justification is, and then we've had to apply it with Old Testament people. But I think it shows the unity of the scriptures that Paul can go back into the Old Testament and pick out people like Abraham and David and say, look here, they were justified just like we are. It isn't like in the Old Testament it was one way and in the New Testament it's another. Nope. These Old Testament people, though they were before Christ, they look forward to what God was going to do in Christ. We noticed last week that God overlooked was the word Paul used, because he did forgive them in one sense, but in another, Christ hadn't come to pay the penalty. So Paul uses the word overlooked to say that God is anticipating, God knows that Christ will die for those sins. And so he has set up a relationship that is, in fact, temporary, as Larry said, through the law, and the law pointing to Christ, but that in Christ, all of those things are now made right, and God is declared to be both just and the justifier of the sinful.